Dr Eli Silber. I'm a neurologist based at King's College Hospital. I established an MS service in 2000, and together with my colleagues, we continue to look after about 3,000 people with MS throughout the region. You've asked me about stem cell treatment, and I thought it would be helpful for us to decide what stem cells are. And essentially, some cells within our body have the potential to grow into other cells, and we call those pluripotential stem cells. And there are two ways in which stem cells could potentially be used. And the first is completely experimental at this stage, but what we're hoping is that where there are areas where the myelin around the nerve has been lost, that we're able to then give pluripotential stem cells. These are able to go into these areas with lost myelin, and these are able to help with the replacement of myelin to help restore function. And there are some very early studies that are being done at this stage, but as I said, this is still largely experimental. The other use of stem cells is as a rescue therapy. And in people with particularly aggressive disease who have failed currently available potent therapies, what we're doing is we're immune suppressing them with chemotherapy, and we're using the body's own stored stem cells from bone marrow as a rescue so that we can hopefully regenerate the immune system. And our hope is that if we damage the immune system with the chemotherapy and then regenerate it, we're only regenerating potentially good white cells that are going to be protective rather than the white cells that are causing damage. So because of the need to make appropriate decisions and safe decisions, the need to decide who's most likely to benefit from stem cell treatment and to follow people up, we've established a London stem cell group. We meet every 2 months, and people are discussed at this multidisciplinary meeting, and it's a collective decision rather than that of an individual doctor. And we've tried to establish reasonably robust criteria for deciding who should be treated or not. And the first group are people with clear relapsing remitting disease who've been treated with a potent disease-modifying therapy. By that we mean one of the monoclonal drugs, and at the moment that's natalizumab and alemtuzumab. And if a person has had clear relapses with new MRI lesions, despite being on this, we would consider offering them this treatment. We're also offering it to a small group of people with progressive disease, but these are people with a reasonably early onset of progressive disease and with a high level of immune activity. They need to have oligoclonal bands in their spinal fluid, and they need to have new lesions on a repeat scan suggesting ongoing inflammatory activity. We've had support from the MS Trust to audit our results so that everyone who's treated, we can follow up, and then we can eventually decide whether people are benefiting from treatment or not, and to what extent and which groups of people are most likely to benefit from treatment. It's very easy for centers to make claims about success of treatment, but unless you appropriately audit your outcome, we've got no idea of who's benefiting and who's not benefiting from treatment. It's important to realize that stem cells are not a panacea, and they are a potentially dangerous treatment. The way that we're treating people, there is a risk of immune suppression. A number of our patients have had reactivation of infections, particularly Epstein-Barr virus, and this can potentially cause more problems. And what we found is that people with higher levels of disability have tended to do worse with their stem cell treatments and have a longer hospital stays. We also think that it's really important that if a person is on treatment, that they have good links with their local neurology services, their neurologists, their MS nurses, and rehabilitation, so that if they do get through the treatment, they are able to be followed up and supported and rehabilitated appropriately, and that they're not lost to treatment and we're then struggling to be able to continue to care for them. So on balance, we think that there's potential hope. We think that it's a potential treatment for a small selected group of patients, and it needs to be seen amongst the whole spectrum of disease-modifying therapies that we have. There is a glimmer of hope, but there is still considerable caution, and time is going to tell who the most appropriate patients are for treatment. So a number of my patients have told me that they're considering going abroad, and there are some centers that I think are more reputable and others that I would be very cautious with. I think that what one needs to know is what their outcomes are. that it mustn't be seen as a completely safe treatment and that one needs to weigh up the risks and benefits of it. One needs to try and not burn the bridges with your local neurology services, because ultimately you're going to need support from them. And you're then going to need to decide who's going to follow you up from a hematology point of view, making sure that once you've had the treatment, you could be followed up safely. What we don't want to do, a surgeon would never operate on a patient and then send them back to a different country with their wounds still raw. And the same way, we need to make sure that if people are treated, there is good, safe, appropriate follow-up for those patients.